For those of us born in the digital age, it's not every day we get to look at images like this. Each of these tiny translucent photos holds a moment in history, and in this room, there are thousands of them. This is environmental photographer Arthur Tress, and if Instagram were around in the 1960s, Arthur would be its king.
I like showing people in relationship to the world around them, even if I'm doing a portrait or a cityscape, or the effect of man's relationship to nature, how he modifies it and changes it.
Arthur is a Brooklyn native, and in the 1960s and 70s, he used his camera to show the changing landscape surrounding New York City. And during this time, the area was a mess.
The entire waterfront was just piled with junk. There were huge garbage landfills that were spilling all this toxic water into the area's neighborhoods. These great chimneys belching out black smoke gives you an image of hell or the apocalypse.
New York City wasn't always so ominous. In the 1940s, the city saw a great deal of post-World War II prosperity. Buildings rose from concrete to clouds as the skyline took shape and industry thrived. But in the decades to follow, the city began showing the negative effects of its industrial boom.
When you'd go to your window, it'd be covered with dust and dirt. People would have a lot of cases of asthma and coughing, and your eyes would burn. It was like what they have now in China, that big smog.
During the 50s and 60s, New York City looked a lot like Beijing does today. Toxic smog has besieged Beijing for decades, and on some days, residents can't even leave their homes, and there are documented widespread health problems among its population, akin to the problems felt in New York. Now, the ill effects of toxic smog come down to these little guys, particulates, tiny microscopic solid particles or liquid droplets suspended in the air, commonly created by burning fossil fuels or wood, as well as power plants and industrial facilities. Particulates suspended in the air vary in size, but essentially, the smaller they are, the deeper they can penetrate your respiratory system, or even your bloodstream. The EPA considers any particle smaller than 2.5 micrometers in diameter extremely hazardous to breathe. And if you can't wrap your head around how small that is, then think about a human hair, which is around 70 micrometers in diameter. That's 30 times larger than fine particulates. Today, these fine particulates are monitored and measured by an air quality index, or AQI for short, where a range of 0 to 50 is considered safe. To put Beijing's pollution crisis into perspective, over the past 5 years, the city saw readings as high as 755. That's so bad, there isn't even a category for it. However, in the 1960s, air pollution wasn't really measured in this way, which does make it difficult to draw a quantifiable comparison. What we do know is that scientists in the 1960s did report extremely elevated levels of damaging air pollutants, such as carbon monoxide and sulfur dioxide in New York City. In 1966, during a period of elevated air pollution known as the killer smog, researchers found an increase in death rate of 24 fatalities per day. And the medical community acknowledged the toll air pollution was taking on people's health, with one city medical examiner remarking, "On the autopsy table, it's unmistakable. The person who spent his life in the Adirondacks has nice pink lungs. The city dwellers are black as coal." But for those who lived outside of the city, some of the most impactful evidence of the hazardous pollution that plagued New York were photographs, like Arthur's. And his photos became an important catalyst in the fight to clean up the city.
The movement for doing that began with me, actually, in the 1960s. The images I created, like a thunderstorm over a New York cemetery or the man coming through the smoke, became very well known as kind of environmental imagery.
Arthur's images were published in magazines and put on posters in the hopes that they would be seen by those who had the power to enforce change.
We must act, and act decisively. It is literally now or never.
In the 1970s, President Richard Nixon introduced environmental policies and programs intended to clean up America. He created the Environmental Protection Agency, and companies dumping toxic waste into waterways and releasing pollutants into the air were finally held accountable.
When the EPA came along and said, no, you can't keep doing that, we have clean water and clean air standards. You know, it wasn't easy, it took time because these corporations fight back as much as they can. But eventually it did turn the tide.
Over time, New York City transformed into the metropolis we know today. And throughout the past several decades, we've learned just how fragile the environment really is.
The photographs were not only important for themselves at the time, but became a reference for the future.
And as we face an uncertain future, Arthur's images will continue to help remind us how easily we could revert back to a toxic world. It may come as a surprise that President Richard Nixon created the Environmental Protection Agency, but protecting the planet wasn't always so political. Check out our video here. Thanks for watching Seeker, and make sure to like and subscribe for new videos every day.